According to Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr., taxes are what we pay for a civilized society. This is what's inscribed on top of the IRS building in Washington. Since the beginning of civilization, there have been taxes. When I speak right now, there are still taxes. And in order to have a civilization, we must pay taxes. The thing is, taxes aren't the issue. We know we have to pay taxes. The issue is the system in which we pay these taxes. We know we must pay these taxes, and we also must know where they come from. So, throughout this journey, I will cover the history of taxes, starting with ancient civilizations, moving to pre- and post-revolutionary America, and then finishing with the 1980s up until about the early 2000s. To begin this trip, we start with ancient civilization. According to Charles Adams, the author of For Good and Evil, the impact of Taxes on the Course of Civilization, during the reigns of Egyptian pharaohs, the first implemented tax that we see in history is a tax on cooking oil. Now, we're audited when we go to pay our taxes, just like they were back then. They were audited by scribes who would go home to home, making sure that people weren't avoiding their taxes by using different means of cooking. Now, if we move to the Roman Empire with Caesar Augustus, he had a tax on inheritance. So, say my father were to die, in order to inherit land that he left me, I would have to pay a 5% tax. No one likes paying taxes, especially not back then, just to get stuff that your dad left. Now, as time moved on, so did taxes. So we move ourselves to colonial America, where we had small taxes such as the Molasses Act, the Sugar Act, and the Stamp Act, and history's history. We all know about tar and feathering because people didn't want to pay their taxes. But it wasn't because they didn't want to pay taxes at all. It's because they were taxed without being represented and having their natural rights. So, after the Revolutionary War, taxes didn't start up right away because there were rebellions in the 1790s and war in the 1810s, and we could never get a formal tax system started up until 1864. Now, in 1864, we passed the first income tax, where it's a bracket system kind of like we have today. It was a 5%, 7.5%, and 10% income tax based on what you made. Just like today, we have tax brackets that are 7 different brackets, as low as 15% and as high as 39%. Now, from ancient times to post-revolution, old times shaped the way that we have taxes today. Now, following all these tax acts that were passed from about the Lincoln era to 1913, we finally get the 16th Amendment. The 16th Amendment allowed Congress to give us, it allowed them to create income taxes and actually enforce them. And so we have this time from 1913 to about the 1980s where taxes stayed about the same. They never really changed. And the government generated some good money. Not all the time did we have a positive deficit where we were making money. Not all the time did we have a negative deficit, but it was pretty even. Now, in the 1980s, under the Reagan administration, the U.S. passed its largest tax cut, which was $750 billion over the course of 6 years. And by doing this, they wanted to give people a tax break for the first time. But they ended up passing 2 more tax acts that just increased taxes to kind of even it up. And then in 1986, Reagan passed the Tax Act of 1986, which reduced tax on the wealthy from 50% to 28% and increased business tax to kind of even it out. And that's where we get Reaganomics, where the rich people will help create jobs for the poor, but we saw that didn't work out. And so, from the end of Reagan's administration and Bush Sr.'s, we get tax acts about every year from 1986 to about 1990, and it just made our tax code that we have today more long and more complex, and that's not what we need. Now, we move to 1993 when Bill Clinton's in office, and he gets his first chance to pass a tax act. And what he did was cut the federal deficit and lower taxes for the people. And by doing this, according to Brooks Johnson, a writer for factcheck.org, Clinton was the last president that actually had a positive deficit as president. Over here, we have when Reagan was president and Bush was president, and that's what they left. And once Clinton got his policies going, we actually made money as a country. Now, following Clinton's presidency and moving into the millennium, we had a lot of changes, including in the tax act, or in the tax code. In 2001, Bush passed the tax act that would save taxpayers $1.3 trillion over the next 10 years. And over his time, he passed five tax acts that sped up the process, which just gave us a negative deficit. And from his presidency through Obama's, now we have a negative deficit of about $600 billion. In conclusion, the tax system is a mess and needs to change. Tax has been around ever since ancient times, and it isn't leaving anytime soon. And if we want a tax system that favors us all, we need to do something. And I'm not talking about we need to pass more acts. The last thing we need is more acts. We need complete revision and a complete rewrite of the tax that we have today to favor everyone and the government. Thank you.